only attracted to things that'll bring the trauma. Overseas, yeah, we trying to stop terrorism, but we still got terrorists here living in the USA, the big CIA, the Bloods and the Crips and the KKK. But if you only have love for your own race, then you only leave space to discriminate, and to discriminate only generates hate, and when you hate, then you're bound to get irate. Yeah, madness is what you demonstrate, and that's exactly how anger works and operates. Man, you gotta have love just to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love, y'all, y'all.
People killing, people dying, children hurting, hearing them crying. Can you practice what you preach and what you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning.
Strange, is the world insane? If love and peace is so strong, why are the pieces of love that don't belong? Nations dropping bombs, chemical gases filling lungs of little ones with ongoing suffering. As the youth are young, so ask yourself, is the loving really gone? So I could ask myself, really what is going wrong in this world that we living in? People keep on giving in, making wrong decisions, only visions of them liberty. Not respecting each other, denying thy brother. A war's going on, but the reason's undercover. The truth is kept secret, it's swept under the rug. If you never know truth, then you never know love. What's the love, y'all? Come on,
I don't know.
What's the truth, y'all? Come on,
I don't know.
What's the love, y'all?
People killing, people dying, children hurting, healing, crying. Can you practice what you preach and what you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning.
The world on my shoulder. As I'm getting older, your people gets colder. Most of us only care about money making. Selfishness got us following the wrong direction. Wrong information always shown by the media. Negative images is the main criteria. Infecting the young minds faster than bacteria. Kids wanna act like what they see in the cinema. Whatever happened to the values of humanity? Whatever happened to the fairness and equality? Instead of spreading love, we're spreading animosity. Lack of understanding leading us away from unity. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling under. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling down. It's no wonder why sometimes I'm feeling under. Gotta keep my faith alive till love is found. Ask yourself,
where is the love? Where is the love? Where is the love? Father,
Father, help us.
Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning. Where is the love?
Sing with me, y'all.
One word, one word.
We only got
one word, one word.
That's all we got.
One word, one word.
There's something wrong with it. Yeah. Something's wrong with it. Yeah. Something's wrong with the good world, world. Yeah, we only got
one word, one word.
That's all we got.
One word.
Everybody, welcome to part two of All You Want to Know About Hoodoo and its practices by the great and wonderful Catherine Yronwode. This is part two. Last week, we discussed Catherine's life, how she got to where she is now. And in case you missed it, Catherine Yronwode is the co-proprietor of the Lucky Mojo Curio Company, a manufactory for traditional herb-based conjure supplies, and the pastor of Missionary Independent Spiritual Church. Her books on folk magic and divination include HooDoo Herb and Root Magic, HooDoo in Theory and Practice, Throwing the Bones and Paper in My Shoe. She lives in Northern California with her husband, a dog, cats and chickens. And so, welcome to the show, Cat.
Well, thank you so much for having me back. I'm very pleased to be here.
Okay, let's talk about your book. You, I guess, debuted them last year at the festival. Do you hold this festival every year, the virtual HooDoo Heritage Festival?
Well, yes and no. My friend, Ms. Robin, started the festivals back in 2008. The first one was held in Alameda, California. And then because rental was an issue, we decided to hold them at my couple acres that my husband and I own, where our shop is located, just out in the countryside. And people liked it. They came to see the shop. And most years we would put them on. They were on virtual. They were real. We ended up buying big tents and we rented chairs and we had hundreds of people on the property. But I told people I would retire when I turned 72. So last year that festival was held virtually because of COVID. And it was managed and organized by a man named Dr. Jeremy Weiss. And so he held it. It was held by Zoom. I was a participant, but I have officially retired from hosting them. But yeah, they go on every year. And this year, we're going to do it virtually again. It's going to be in September, September 11th to 12th. It'll be a Zoom conference. Hundreds of people will sign up. When you sign up, you get goodie boxes. If you sign up in time, there'll be boxes of things that you can make and do while the Zoom lessons are going on, and they will be sent to you by priority mail. And we have 10 different workshops. And again, Ms. Robin is in charge. She's always been in charge. I'm kind of, you know, the public face of it, but Ms. Robin is the woman who has run the damn thing. And okay. And you can find her at AIR too, Ms. Robin. And this time she's joined by Lady Muse of Blue Flag Root Radio. She's a podcast, and Lady Muse and Miss Michael of the Caroline Dye Memorial Chapel, and Deacon Millett, who has Four Altars Gospel Sanctuary. So they are the committee this time. The committee changes, you know, who's in charge every year has changed, but I will no longer be on the committee. I'll always be a participant as long as I can.
Okay, gotcha. All right, let's talk about your books, your recent ones. Bottle Up and Go.
Oh, this is a good book. And it's one of those books that, you know, I've written a lot of books and I've been in the publishing business a long time and I've co-written a number of books. Every once in a while, you start a book and you go, this one is going to take a while to take off, but when people get it, they're really going to get it. And the last time this happened was a book I wrote called Paper in My Shoe. And it was just about writing petition papers, putting them in your shoe, putting them in a mojo, putting them in your bosom, putting them between the pages of the Bible, whatever you were going to do with this paper. It was called Paper in My Shoe. And the same thing has happened with Bottle Up and Go. So this is about hoodoo spells that you can place inside of something, a box, a can, a bottle, a jar, a freezer, anything, you know, inside of something, inside of a lamp, inside of a candle, by loading the candle wax with your spell. And the spells themselves can be for good, for love, for money, for health, for peace, for prosperity, or they can be for evil, to harm someone, to send someone away, or they can be for unity among people. They can be to separate people, because there's many different spells. But what these all have in common, they are worked in a jar. So it could be a sweet jar of honey. Then we also even cover dolls, you know, because it's inside the doll. So this book was co-written with my friend Lara Rivera. And it was one of those things, everyone was like, I don't get it. What's it about? It's just about spells that are united by a methodology, not by an outcome, not by a condition that you want to fix or achieve. Just a methodology. And that's the same as with Paper in My Shoe. When you work according to a methodology, you end up with about 100 spells. There's more than 100 spells about how to use that methodology for many outcomes. And so this book has we brought it out last October at the festival, virtual Peru Heritage Festival, and it has taken off at Amazon. All of a sudden, people woke up and they went, "We need this book." so
I know for a fact they're out of it.
they're out of it. I'm not surprised because they just ordered another case of them. So yeah, it's going fast. Just keep on ordering it, folks. Order through Amazon, and we'll all make a little income on it. So there's sweet jars. There are cigar boxes. There's ammonia jars. There's rotten jars. There's matchbooks. There's coffin boxes. It's pretty much everything organized according to how it's performed. But then we also put out a line of books about types of outcomes. Like we have a book on money magic. And it's money magic by all methodologies. See, this is bottle magic for all reasons. They kind of overlap. Right. So okay. I love this book, and I love Lara, who worked on it with me. It's a really wonderful book. And I did a video on it for the HooDoo Heritage Festival. And eventually I'm going to get that video uploaded at my site. We'll see about that. If you buy the book, I'll probably just let you have the video if you buy it from me rather than from Amazon. We haven't gotten there yet. I'm slow on that technology.
Okay. What about The Stranger in the Cup?
Well, The Stranger in the Cup is another one of these funny little things. This book is a book on divination. So I'm a diviner, I'm a reader, and I'm a fortune teller. And I love different methods of divination. And for many years, going back to 2008, 2009, I had a web page called themystictearoom.com, and I talk about tea leaf reading there, and I have a very large collection of fortune telling teacups. These are teacups that were made to tell a fortune. They're not plain inside. They might have playing cards, and they might have signs of the zodiac, or they might have different symbols like a fish or a cat or something like that that has a meaning. And so I've collected these, and I've taken photographs of them. I put them online, and I was talking with a friend of mine, Papa G, Gregory Lee White is his name. He lives in Nashville, and he collects some of these cups too. He's younger than me. He doesn't have as many cups as I do. And we were talking about how there's really no book that tells all about tea leaves and these collectible cups, and also teaches you how to read a plain teacup. So he and I have been friends. We're both Tauruses, and we love items, objects, and he's very good at graphics. So is my husband, Nagashiva, and we just went to town. We created this book in very few weeks. We worked so hard. We were working, 18, 20 hour days to get this thing out, and we did it's a beautiful book. Now, a fortune-telling book never sells as well as a spell book, but this book is good, and I hope that anybody who wants to read tea leaves, there are many, many books on tea leaf reading, but this is the only one that really tells you a lot about the history and why tea leaf reading is considered to be women's fortune-telling, and therefore it is denigrated or deprecated because it's not the same. I mean, when I wrote that book on bone throwing back in, I think it was 2012, Throwing the Bones, everybody wanted to read bones. I mean, as soon as that book came out, everybody went on YouTube and lied and said their grandmother had taught them how to read bones. And, I mean, they bought the book and they all of a sudden were instant experts, took off. Tea leaf reading is a little different. There aren't a lot of macho men who want to say, my grandmother taught me how to read tea leaves. So tea leaves is a female form of fortune telling, and a lot of gay men will do it too. And
which is older, tea leaf reading or bone throwing?
Bone reading is much older, and in African American culture, bone reading comes from Africa. Tea leaf reading actually enters into hoodoo and enters into general American folklore, no matter what background you have, through contact with Scottish people. They didn't read black tea, from China or India. They read herbs in a cup. there's been a lot of FACO when tea leaf reading became really, really popular around 1890. A lot of people said, oh, we got it from China. No, they got the tea from China. But the tea leaf reading actually comes out of the Middle East coffee ground reading. And I do believe it was brought by the Crusaders from the Middle East to Scotland, where they began to read herbal teas. And the whole system of tea leaf reading is very English, Irish, and Scottish. And it's beautiful. But it entered into hoodoo very early on after emancipation. And black tea leaf readers are numerous. And also gypsy Roma people read tea leaves. It's a European thing, but it's all over America.
Right. Because that was one of the first divinatory practices that I got into. And I think I was around 11 or 12.
And you and me, so similar. Me too.
I know.
We're like sisters somehow. That's so funny. You know what? See, I read about it, or I heard about it somewhere. Maybe I saw it in a movie. I don't know. I saw something about it. And I grew up in the East Bay. We were in Oakland, and we went to a Chinese restaurant. It was a dim sum lunch restaurant. And I just was kidding around. I was a little kid, you know, like 10 or 11 years old. And I said, I can read our tea leaves to my, you know, to my family. And I just turned the teacup and I, you know, you turn it over and you twirl it. And I read it, and what I read came true. And I went, oh my. So yeah, that's it.
Yeah. And it's weird because like you and I, we're from the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was fortunate for me, because like my granddaddy was the pastor of our Pentecostal church.
Which church was it?
It was the Church of God in Christ. It was on Peralta and.
Oh my God! Excuse me, but oh my, I know that church. I think I knew your daddy. I know Church of God in Christ.
Ago.
Yes.
Yeah.
On Peralta. Oh yes.
It was a little church. You know, people, you know, it was basically family members in there, but he would go to the door and welcome anybody in, everybody walking by in, you know, go down to the old man's park and, you know, invite people down there to come in. But he would tell us stories, you know, like the bone reading. And if you knew my grandfather, you knew he didn't lie.
Mm-hmm.
And he was, I'd say that it's because of watching him throughout my life that I know that it is possible for people to truly live a godly life, you mm-hmm. know, without judgment or any of that type of thing, just very humble and praising everything and turning the other cheek, even though in his young days he was a temper person, you know.
Yes.
But yes. He told a story in church one day about a pastor from down south in Louisiana, Baton Rouge, Shreveport area, that had boiled a black cat.
Mm-hmm.
And he would take. And I know this happened because he wouldn't for sure in church lie about it.
Right.
He was a youngster then, just getting into the men. And the man would take the bones and test each one, put it in his mouth until he could become invisible.
Yes.
My granddaddy said, that man, you could not see him.
Yes. I'm going to tell you, I first learned that exact same thing from someone from Louisiana. And again, for those who don't know that time and that place, a lot of shipyard workers had come from Louisiana and settled in the East Bay. And so, and I, that's where I learned this stuff. And yes, I heard that if you put the right bone between your teeth, you would not be seen, you would be invisible.
Right.
And the person who told me this said, but you got to be right. You cannot use it to steal. If you use your invisibility to steal, God's going to see you anyway. But if you use your invisibility, you know, because you need to, that's something else. But don't use it to become a thief, he said.
Right.
So, yeah, that's right. You and I are from the same time and place. That is so interesting. That is so interesting. A lot of people have said, you know, you have to grow up in the South to have learned this. But I found out you can have grown up in the East Bay. You could have grown up in Hunters Point. You could have grown up in Detroit. You could have grown up in Chicago. This is all over the country.
Yeah, and it is, and it's really kind of misunderstood. People hear the word hoodoo, and they immediately go to a negative stereotype.
Yes.
You know, and it's with all, I guess, all things, you know, there's positive and negative. Because the root workings in it is the ones that, you know, I know the older generation, especially some of the church women and stuff like that, when you got sick, you know, they mix a batch of something with euthanasia and some other kind of stuff and tell you to drink it and you're good, you know, you're good to go. So,
well, you know, when I was young, there were more root workers in the Baptist church than in Church of God in Christ. The Church of God in Christ, you had to walk a narrow path, and that was, you know, but they would use herbs for the healing of nations. That was, you know, whatever it was. But hoodoo often meant contact magic. In other words, what you would do to put something on somebody, right? Rather than to just be to heal. And but the Baptists also were more likely you would find, and I don't mean to talk bad about Baptists. I have no horse in that race, but the Baptists were more likely to come and ask for lucky numbers to gamble and lucky numbers to play. And the Church of God in Christ didn't do as much playing with numbers.
Well, they were very strict.
Very strict. But they still would do something to, you know, if someone was falsely arrested, they'd still do something like tumble the house to get, you know, to get the person released. I remember a lady telling me about a man had been arrested, and she didn't want to hurt anybody. She just wanted the man to be released so they would lose all the evidence. And she worked on it until the detective who had gathered all the evidence, he retired, the evidence was lost. They just strung this thing out. And she showed me a brown candle spell she had been working on a honey jar for 6 months or more. And eventually all the charges were dropped. The man got off. And so, but she was a church woman. She was not a spooky, ooky, witchy lady. She was a church lady, you know.
Right. And like in the Pentecostal, they truly believe in the power of prayer and laying on hands and stuff. I said, well, maybe Reiki has stemmed from that.
Yes.
Because that's the new thing and everything, but I've seen it practiced all my life.
That's right. That's
you
right.
Know? And they didn't know anything about chakras or anything like that. It was just their faith, because, like, I remember my grandmother ran down to the church because their firstborn at 40-something, my uncle had pneumonia, and the doctor had sent him home to die.
Oh, my.
And my grandmother was a Baptist. And my grandfather was Holiness Church. And so she ran down, literally ran with the baby down to the church and brought there, and everybody got around, and daddy started praying over it and laying on hands. And, you know, my uncle just died last year at 89.
Well, they got him well. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Well, that is the kind of thing I was taught to pray, to use prayer. You mentioned the third book, and I'm going to move on to that book, The Guiding Light to Power and Success by Mikhail Strabo. So this book first came out in 1942. Actually, the first edition of it came out in 41 under a different name, but the version we've got here, The Guiding Light to Power and Success, came out in 42, and it's called A Study of the Use of Candles in the Search for the Truth. Now, when I was young, every hoodoo shop you walked into had a copy of this book, little orange cover, The Guiding Light to Power and Success. Now, I did it with a fancier cover, and I put a few more pages in it, but this book describes the kind of candle work that we did when we were young. There's the single candle. These are not the glass candles that came in with the Latino Catholic practice, which came in kind of in the 70s. This is the older, where you have a household candle or a little altar light, or you have a jumbo candle. And Mount Zion Spiritual Temple, they used to do these candle services, and they recommend this book. So this book went out of print. You know, time passes and people think it's old fashioned and we don't need this book anymore. But I wanted to go back and revisit it. And I have been revisiting quite a few of these occult classics. And I'm trying to give them the gravity and importance that people give to medieval European grimoires. You know, they say, well, this is Cornelius Agrippa or whatever, and this is the Kabbalah. Yeah. And I'm like, no, this is hoodoo. These hoodoo books have existed long, long time. And there's no reason to pretend that practitioners, root doctors, conjure workers didn't have books, and that Black culture was illiterate. So this book, The Guiding Light, was, like I said, I first bought this probably when I was 14 years old, and it was so well written. I found out about the man who called himself Mikhail Strabo. Now, Strabo is a Greek name. There was a Greek historian named Strabo, and Mikhail, like Mikhail Gorbachev, is a Russian name, but he was neither Russian nor was he Greek. He was really a Jewish man named Sidney J.R. R for Rosenfeld, Sidney J. Rosenfeld Steiner. But he didn't pretend to be Black either. He learned all of this from a white woman named Adele Clemens, who had back in the 20s and 30s integrated herself into Black culture in Harlem. She was one of those unusual people who jumped the line back when there was a line, when you couldn't be a white woman in Harlem. And she was a lover of and lived with Major Reverend Divine. And she was a spiritual medium. And she met Julia Steiner, who was Jewish. And he said, well, I'm so interested. Now, she was not Jewish. She was a European type white woman. She, in fact, claimed to be related to Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens, Mark Twain, the author. She was a Ms. Clemens, and she was from back east somewhere. So she began teaching this stuff to Sidney Steiner, and he then started going to Black churches and writing it down and talking to people about it. So he then put this fake name on himself because he didn't want people to know he was Jewish, because World War II was going on, and he was afraid. You know, Nazis were out there, and he was afraid of anti-Semitic hate. So what he wrote this book, and it's this beautiful combination. He has a little bit of Catholic stuff. He has a little bit of Jewish stuff, but 90% of it is African-American. And it's just a wonderful book. And I was so happy to retypeset it, bring it along. It was a 64-page book. But when I do my books, they're 96 pages. So I just added things. I added some things that came from the interviews that Harry Middleton Hyatt interviewed Black root workers. And some of them were already using the style of work that's in this book. In other words, it showed me that Steiner was on the right track. In other words, that what Hyatt found was around the same time, but he hadn't published it. And these spells I included. And it's really been a lot. This was a real labor of love. And it's a very, very good book. So you end up with things like burning 7 candles in a row, or burning candles on a certain day of the week, like burning on Wednesday for speech and gaming for Mercury, because that's, you know, the planet that rules that day. Or it might be how to do 8 days, a sacred octave of purity using white candles, saying Psalms 51 and using the seals of Moses, number 10. And all of these have psalms with them. And this is why this book was so used by church people when I was growing up, because he put a psalm with every candle. And he was very well-intentioned man who knew his business. He was afraid, it's sad to say, he was afraid to say he was Jewish. He was afraid of being hated on or threatened. So he would just say, this is a book for people of all faiths. And that was it.
Yeah,
so wow. he was passing as white. It's kind of an interesting book. And you have to look at, I wrote a little biography of him at the end. You have to open your heart just a little bit and go, where did this man come from? Because when I was a kid, I thought, well, with the name Michael Strabo, he can't be black. But why is he writing a book about black candle magic? And yet in every place I went, and places like Mount Zion Spiritual Temple, everybody had this book. People from Louisiana had this book. So, what it was.
Wow.
It's a historical moment.
Yeah, I mean, wow. I said, okay, I want to go get my book. That was really cool. Because now I know so much about the history of the author who, you know, started it, that it's just going to be really more precious.
Well, I want to tell you one other little funny thing, all right? So Jews have a use of oil lamps back in the old ancient days, you know, the oil lamps. And I'm sure you've heard of, like, the festival of Hanukkah, where you have the lights going for all this.
Right.
Well,
and
then when the Romans invaded Israel and kicked the Jews out, I mean, they had to flee for their lives. They ended up in Europe. And olive oil was not common because it's a Mediterranean oil. So they started making candles in the Northern European style. When Jews came to America, they were very good candle makers. And when I was a kid, most of the suppliers, companies that supplied candles to the Catholic Church were run by Jews. So this man, Mr. Steiner, was well familiar with candles because it was such a Jewish thing. But what Mr. Hyatt had found about 6 years earlier, he was traveling through the South. And people would say, well, yeah, we just use plain white candles over here. Well, but when he got on along the Louisiana, the Gulf Coast, and going up the river toward Memphis, people said, oh, we use colored candles, red for this and yellow for that and so forth. And Hyatt said, there's something new here going on. This candle magic is taking off around 1936. And he got to Memphis and he interviewed a man named Reverend Young. And Reverend Young said, yes, all of this candle magic has come up the river from Louisiana and is spreading north. And by the time you and I come along, it was everywhere. But this book, Mr. Steiner's book, is kind of like when candle magic hit New York, 1942. So it's just this spread of candle magic.
Wow. Wow. I have a friend, she passed suddenly last December. She's living in Canada, but her roots are Lithuanian,
mm-hmm.
and she always considered herself a gypsy, and we used to do readings together. We were in a little private group of, I think there were about 11 of us, and her thing was she was so good at the candle magic,
mm-hmm.
and I would tell her, you know, come on, Lorraine, I want you to teach that, you know, show, mm-hmm. because she was good at it.
Mm-hmm.
That and her dad, may he rest in peace, he was good at sigils.
Uh-huh.
He would do what we know as sigils.
Rental, right.
And place them, you know, like he drew bulldogs and put them around his property to protect it.
Wow.
And that, I mean, you know, when you're raised in the church, Kat, you know, people are constantly telling you that, you know, your gifts or talents are, oh, they're the, of the devil, or they're this, you know, and repress. I don't know where they pick this up to feel so strongly about it, but I think when they do that, they really oppress the gifts that people have.
Yeah. They make, you know, people feel guilty for having that gift.
Yeah.
But, you know, to me, well, I was raised, see, now I was raised Jewish, so I believe in the prophets. I believe in the gift of prophecy. That's right. One reason why I like to go down on the, in those little churches, down on Peralta, down on San Pablo, little church where if you walk by, the little boy would come out dressed in his little suit and his little white shirt, and he'd hand you a tambourine, right? And he'd say,
yeah,
here's your tambourine, come on in. And, you know, that those people prophesied. They did not believe that prophecy was dead. And they did not believe that healing by anointing with oil was dead. And they did not believe that miracles had ceased to happen. And so for me, those churches were very welcoming, even though I was obviously Jewish, but nobody, of course, that was in the day, you know, civil rights movement. I think people understood we all have to be together to help one another, or we're not going to be able to make a change against structural, you know, imperialism, racism, colonialism, and you name it, you know. So,
yeah.
You know, when we're coming up on Passover, and when I was young, I was taught when we have Passover, you can, the service that you do, it's a home service. You don't do it at a temple or any place like that. It's always done in the home. And you make your own little order of services, and you make your own quotes from the Bible or from literature or whatever you want to do, your own songs. And everybody makes, every family and group has their own little way of doing it. And in my family, who were very left wing, we always took the idea that just as God released us from the Egyptian captivity and the Babylonian captivity, so we must align ourselves with Black people so that they would be released from captivity. And in those days, there wasn't a lot of identity politics. It was more like, are we working for the same goal? You know what I'm talking about.
Right.
And so I was really given a real schooling in how to do Christian magic. And I went with it. My Jewish friends would say, how can you do this? Why do you call on Jesus' name? I said, well, because that's how I was taught, you know.
Yeah.
And but I, when I teach hoodoo, there are people who really have a difficulty with it, because they say, well, I wanted to learn all about witchcraft, and I want to learn how to curse people. And I'm like, no, this all comes out of a whole idea of what life should be like, to have a good life. And if somebody wants to go around just doing evil, well, they're just an evil person. It doesn't matter whether they use hoodoo or whether you use a machine gun. They're just evil. So all of this work that I learned, as I said, came out of the spiritualist church, Church of Religious Science, Baptist Church, Holiness Church, Pentecostal Church. And I was able to share some things I knew from my own family, but I just kept my ears and eyes open. And I learned that some of the very best work was done by church people.
Yeah. And you can, I mean, you can even look at it like if you've, you know, and I'm sure you have, you've been into one of those churches where when they get to feeling the spirit, they dance around and
fall out. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and you don't see that in a lot of other churches. And that's why whatever I do with my prayers and stuff like that, I'm definitely always calling on the Spirit of God.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
You know, because they totally ignore the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And in my mind, that's the female essence. I just look at it. I always, when I talk to it, I'm always talking to a feminine form.
Yes.
And that in my prayers and my works and my healings is the one that I call on and is the one that I feel the closest to. I thank, you know, I thank God that I'm aware of that, because there must be something special about that spirit that gets inside of us.
Yes. And you know what?
Go ahead.
I was going to say, this goes back to what I was saying before about tea leaf reading, and that it's considered to be. I mean, there's no reason it is. Well, maybe people look at the cup shape and they go, oh, it must be female because it's a cup. Somehow, or maybe it's domestic, it takes place in a kitchen table where you're sitting reading the tea leaves. The idea that female magic and female divination is less valuable than male magic and male divination is something that women have both struggled with and subverted. And so when you go to a hoodoo lady to get your business fixed, you are in a way bypassing the male patriarchy religion that says that only an ordained pastor, priest, male lineage person can help you. Now, the churches have gotten wise. The churches have gotten wise. There are churches now that allow women pastors. There are churches now that allow gay pastors, lesbian pastors. But back in the day, it was pretty much yes or no. I mean, if you know what I'm saying? It was difficult to find anybody who would do spiritual work who was not either authoritarianly, hierarchically clerical, or they were some old lady from Louisiana, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, and so when you talk about calling on the female spirit, I hear you, because you're talking about the ancestress, the woman healer of the past. I sometimes, because I'm Jewish, I come from a lineage that purports to come from long time ago. And so I was told, well, you know, King Solomon, he was the wisest man in the world. But then I began reading about the Queen of Sheba, his African wife. And I began to think, that's a spirit too. That's a spirit who is one of power. And there are, in Judaism, we have the matriarchs, you know. So I began to look at this thing in terms of what spirit could I call upon? I often call upon the spirit of the Queen of Sheba. I call upon the spirit of Sarah, Miriam, those women of power. And it may be that to some people this is heresy, but I don't feel it. I never believed that God should go away and be replaced by a goddess. But I think that divinity is bigger than, you know, a male or a female.
Right, exactly. And since you're going to do the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, my even in my child's mind, to me, it was saying the Father, the Son, and the Mother.
Right. Oh, yeah, me too. I understand that completely.
As a child, and that's the way I've always addressed it, and it has never failed me. So
that's right.
You know,
the Father, always the Father, the Mother, and the child. That's right. Well,
right.
And to be a child of God and Goddess is where I would wish to be.
Yeah.
I have to say that one of the very first things I bought to put on a little home altar. You could call it an altar, a little working space where I was doing things. One of the very first things I bought that was kind of off my track, you know, the track that I'd been raised up in, was I bought a little Catholic statue of the Holy Family. It was Joseph, Mary, and Jesus. And it was this cute little plaster statue. I still have it. And I looked at that and I thought, that's it. That's what I like. So I often will because see, being Jewish, I didn't think Jesus was the son of God. I thought Jesus was the son of Joseph. That's how I looked at it. So Joseph, Mary, and Jesus. And so that was my little prayer. I was just a teenager at the time, but I still have that statue.
Wow. Wow. Let's talk about the Spiritist Church.
All right.
You're a pastor. Tell everyone what that is.
Well, the Spiritualist Church is quite a wide area. So it started in the mid 1800s, supposedly with the Fox sisters, but actually maybe not. That's where the word spiritualist kind of started. Calling up spirits of the dead, being a trance medium, goes back a lot farther than that. And probably one of the earliest spiritualists in America was a man named Pascal Beverly Randolph. Now, he was, I guess you could say, biracial. I don't, you know, it's hard to say who or what, where he came from, because he tried to pass. And when he tried to pass, he was too dark to pass for white, but he could pass for Spanish. But he wasn't Spanish. His name was Randolph, and his family was from Virginia. His mother was named Flora, and it's very likely his father was a white owner of Flora, who was a slave. He was born in 1825 during slavery, and his father apparently set him and his mother free, and so he just made his own reality. I mean, you know, in those days, you know what I'm saying, the man had to make his own reality. But he was a spiritualist. He called himself the Rosicrucian, and he was a spirit medium. And by the time the Spiritualist Church really got started in the 1850s, 1860s, he was doing transmediumship and was a really a great root worker. He also talked about hoodoo. He told how to make what he called the New Orleans magnetic pillow so that you could dream of the one you loved. Had probably magnetic sand in it, you know, in the pillow. He was a very interesting man. So spiritualism has two faces. There's the white face of spiritualism that starts with the Fox sisters, and it proceeds and it goes to England and Australia, and it becomes very popular around World War I, because people were dying in far distant places and the grieving families wanted to contact their spirits. They often wanted to find their graves. They wanted to find out what had happened. And so spiritualism had this real bloom of interest starting in the Civil War. Wars tend to bring it out. So the Civil War is when the first American big wave of spiritualism came. Then by World War I, it was all over the white Anglophone world. And there was also a French form of it called spiritism, as opposed to spiritualism. And by that time, Pascal Beverly Randolph had passed away. He passed in 1875. But his followers remained. And there was a woman named Leafy Anderson, and she grew up in Wisconsin. And she said, and there's no reason to disbelieve her, that she was part Native American. And she began to hold spiritual services that were more like a Black Baptist church. There was speaking in the spirit, speaking in tongues, dancing. Those things happened in that spiritual church because they came out of a Black cultural tradition. And spiritualism then kind of... people were joining the spiritualist church in the first years rather than being born into it. So they brought to it what they had been taught. So there were Catholic type spiritualist churches where people would wear robes and a little beretta cap, and, you know, and they would have all, you know, I mean, they looked like they were little popes and cardinals, and they were spiritualists in that way. And then there were other spiritualists that were black, and they looked more Pentecostal or more Baptist. And they also were became influenced by another group called the New Thought Movement, which was about affirmative prayer, affirmative self-development, thinking your way to health and things like that. And a lot of spiritualists took up New Thought. So there were New Thought spiritualist churches. All right. Well, in 1922, which was the height of the Jim Crow, after World War I, when black people were starting to be in the military and get rights and things like that, there was that kickback by those white Southerners to start the Jim Crow laws and really put segregation in place. And in 1922, the National Spiritualist Association of Churches ejected all black spiritualist churches. They just said, you're not part of us anymore. Oh yeah, this was pretty heavy. And so the black ones formed something called the Colored Spiritualist Churches of America. And so the Colored Spiritualist Churches of America were really centered around where Leafy Anderson had what we call seated churches in New Orleans and Philadelphia and Chicago. She'd gone from place to place, and she had also taught the veneration of Black Hawk, the spirit of Black Hawk, the Native American warrior who she felt was necessary to protect black communities from white incursions, riots, so-called riots, burning down the black part of town and things like that.
Right.
So they were these Black Hawk services, and she was very good at it. Well, she passed away. She was succeeded by a woman named Catherine Seals, Mother Catherine Seals in New Orleans. But these different spiritualist churches, there's Metropolitan Spiritualist Church of Christ. Now you can see with the name, they were the Church of Christ at one point, but they became a spiritualist church back in the 20s or teens. They're located in Kansas City. So when I grew up in the East Bay, Mount Zion Spiritual Temple was run by King Louis Narcisse, and he was from New Orleans, and he was a Baptist, not a a lot of New Orleans are Catholic, but he was a Baptist, and that man had a beautiful singing voice, but he was gay, and he didn't say, hey, I'm gay, but you could just tell. And so he had left the Baptist church. Otherwise I love that man. He was so powerful, such a good singer, such a good preacher, had such style and class. He would have been a famous Baptist preacher, but he just went to the spiritualist church, and he started spiritualist churches all around. There was one in Bakersfield, California, Detroit, New Orleans. And so I would attend that, and he was open to white people coming in. You can look on YouTube and you'll find him singing. He put out a record
and I remember him.
Yeah. So I became interested in him. Now, he did these candle services. And it's so funny, before the internet, I would teach people and I'd say, you're going to get a little pan and you're going to put sand in it. And you put your candles in, wrap your prayer on a little slip of paper like a Chinese fortune cookie and put your prayer on it. And on the other side, say that it will be done. And then you go up and the man will hold your hand. And I described these things and people thought, well, she's telling a story about something they'd never seen. And then YouTube came along. And there was a film that someone had made showing him in his home, and he's singing a song called I'm on the Battlefield for My Lord, which is an old Baptist song, and he's singing it, and then the camera pans, and you see all those metal pans that I knew from his church, and I went, oh my God, there, now the proof, this is, you know what I'm saying? This is how it was done. Well, there are people still around that have been part of that church, but it closed when he died. And it's really sad what happened to it. But you can go on YouTube and look up Mount Zion Spiritual Temple. I wish somebody would bring back that kind of service. There's a few others that have been around. Starlight Spiritual Cathedral is another. And they would do Black Hawk services, there was a song they'd sing about Black Hawk is a watcher on the wall. And that was really part of what I grew up, observing, participating in, being an invited guest. I always was very conscious of the fact that I was not living as a Black person. I didn't want to appropriate anything. So I was just a very polite young girl. And the people there were so friendly to me. And I learned a lot of spell work with candles out of that Mount Zion Spiritual Temple. They did candle magic. Really good.
Now, when you do your candle magic, do you have certain songs that you use, or do you?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Which are your favorites?
Psalms 23, the all-purpose psalm. That'll work for everything. If you can only remember one psalm, Psalms 23. There's a long history, and this history comes out of the Jewish faith.
That's right.
Using the Psalms for magic. And so there's a book called Secrets of the Psalms, which again used to be sold in every hoodoo shop when I was a child. And Secrets of the Psalms is basically an English translation of a German translation of the Hebrew book called On the Uses of the Psalms, Shemoth Tehillim. And so, but we would have, I mean, I would, you have to understand my surprise when someone would say to me, oh, you know, you're going to say Psalms 91, and you're going to use the candlestick seal from the sixth and seventh books of Moses. And it's this little, it looks like a little sigil. It looks like a little candlestick, a little with arms on it, like a little Jewish menorah. And they'd say, just use that. And I'd say, okay, Psalms 91. But then I started looking at it and reading up about it. The little letters here don't make words that make that candlestick. It's the first letter of every word of Psalms 91. So it's like it's like they defined or refined and distilled Psalms 91 to the first letter of every word, and they made it in the form of a little candlestick. But I was taught that not by a Jewish person. I was taught that by a Black root worker in Oakland.
Now we have three questions, Kat, for you.
Okay, sure.
Okay, Thomas on LinkedIn asks, isn't that what the Catholic Church does when they light the white candles, candle magic?
Yes, I believe they do. Now, I'm not anyone to force that on them and tell them, you're doing magic, don't you know it?
Right.
But yes, I would say that is exactly what they're doing. And I would also go so far as to say that the difference between the spiritualist church and some of these others is they openly acknowledge that they're doing it.
Right. Okay. Regina on Facebook asked, does candle magic really work to speak to the dead?
Well, all right. Candle magic is separate from speaking to the dead. A lot of people will use a candle to focus their attention. You can use a candle to do what's called astral travel. You can use a candle to do work where you get into somebody's dreams. But many people will use a candle on the anniversary of someone's death or the anniversary of their birth, but usually the anniversary of their death, to continue the conversation. Use a white candle. In Jewish tradition, it's called the Yahrzeit candle, which means the year time, the anniversary. Or memorial candle is what I was taught by my Black friends. They said, well, you light a memorial candle on the anniversary of their home going, and then you can speak to them if you have that gift. But you can also speak to the dead in other ways. There are people who simply go into a trance and speak to the dead. They don't need, want, or use a candle. So these are like two circles that overlap, you know, and where they overlap, you have candle magic to contact the dead. But candle magic exists separately. Contacting the dead exists separately. Another way to contact the dead is, and I've done it, I'll ask people, bring me a piece of jewelry that person wore next to their skin, not just one time, but something they really wore. Their wedding ring is a good one, or a pendant that they wore. And I can just hold it in my hand, close my eyes, put my hand, and I put my hand, close my hand like a little fist, and put that up on my forehead with my the heel of my hand resting on my on the bridge of my nose, and I'll lean on my elbow. I've done this so often. I lean on my elbow, and I'll say, "All right, are you there? Will you speak to me?" And very often they will.
Wow! asked if candle magic is also used within blood magic.
Well, I don't know what you mean by blood magic. So again, I'm going to make a guess here. There's two things that are called blood magic. One is the blood that comes from a killing or sacrificing an animal or a person. And there are people who are wicked enough to kill people to get their blood. I'm not going to speak in faith. No, I'm not. It's not my thing. And I don't have any.
Yeah. You
know, there are people who want to use the blood of a dying animal. That's one form of blood magic. It really has very little to do with candles. You could add candles to it, but I don't practice that type of magic. There's another thing called blood magic, which is much more down-home sex magic that comes out of Mediterranean, African, Middle Eastern traditions, which is for women to use their menstrual blood to trap a man or catch a man or make a man stay with them. And again, you don't need a candle to do that, because usually with the menstrual blood, you would be feeding it to the man. I don't know how nasty we can get here, but I'm just saying.
Actually, that's practiced in the prisons by women.
Yes.
You know,
it is.
Today.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I'm going to tell you the truth. The person who taught me how to do that was my grandmother.
Wow. Yeah. And they don't even realize, or maybe they do, because whoever started it, that's what they would do. They would put some of their period blood in a sandwich and make the girl that they were in love with eat it.
That's right. That's right. I'll tell you another one. A woman told me this. Get a piece. If your husband or your man likes liver and onions, you know, some people like that as a dish. Get yourself a piece of liver and stick it up your pussy. Excuse my language, as which I'm quoting. Uh-huh. When you're having your period, and get your period blood on, because liver is kind of bloody. Get your period blood on it. Fry it up. You know, bread it, fry it up with onions, give it to that man, and he will never leave you.
Oh, wow. That's not all.
And she told me that. Well, the woman who told me that, she told me that just like as normal as it is. It's old. It's very old. But you'll find that spell and those types of spells all around Africa, up in Eastern Africa, Ethiopia area. You'll find Egyptians know about it. Jews know about it. Syrians, Lebanese. It goes all up in that area. It's a Mediterranean as well as African practice. And I'm going to tell you another thing. Maybe this gets a little personal. I have met many a black man who will not go down on a woman for fear.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Fear that he might taste her blood.
Yeah.
And I have known many a woman who quickly cleans herself, wipes herself, and gets him to go down so that he will taste her blood.
Wow.
And I know I have known many a woman who has done this. I also have had a number of black woman friends talk to me and say, well, they want to date a white man. And I said, why do you want to date a white man? And they say, because they want someone to go down on them. They've never experienced it, and none of the black men will do it because their mama told them, don't you dare, because she'll get you. So they wanted to date Jewish boys because Jewish boys don't worry about that. That's truth. That is.
I can testify to that.
But no candles were used in that. That was just blood magic.
Yeah. Cora on gab.com asks, what is the magical significance of candles and why are candles so important?
Great question. The book, The Guiding Light to Candles, The Guiding Light to Power and Success by Michael Strabo, really talks about this. And he talks about the idea of light. You know, God said, let there be light. And so the candle is the gift of light, but he then takes it into other cultures like Prometheus and the gift of fire, which was the Greek way of seeing this, and torches and lamps. And if you go back to the Zoroastrians, you know, fire, the philosophy of fire, it was called. So this is the beginning of humanity learning to distinguish themselves from animals, because he who controls fire controls the world. And we've seen it, how it's played out. All of this industrial revolution, electronics, mining, shipping, airplanes, all of that came from the control of fire and the control then of the internal combustion engine. And the candle is that first symbol that you could have light in darkness, that you didn't need to huddle in the dark afraid, that you could have this light. And it was associated with God, but it's also associated with personal power. And you'll see people like the ancient Scottish who they put out all their fires at New Year's, and then they light a new fire. It's called a need fire, and they carry coals from house to house to start that new fire for heat and for light. So these ideas are very important in many, many cultures. So the candle has become a symbol of focus of attention, power, and the ability to change the world so that it conforms to your will and becomes what you wish it to be.
Wow. Wow, we had another question. Hold on, let me. Now, wow, that was. Thomas asks if candle magic is the same as sun magic.
Yes and no. Yes, because the sun is our source of light. No, because as I said, what makes a candle so powerful is that we control it. We cannot control the sun. We can ally ourselves with the sun. For instance, we can say, first day of spring, I'm going to do some spring magic. The sun is growing in power. We can go, midsummer, I wish to have the power of the sun, right? But a candle we can light anytime. When I was young, one of the old women, again down in Oakland, she said, light a candle twice a day. Light it at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. And I said, why do I have to do that? What if I don't get up early enough? She said, well, then light it at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. because candles are also used to mark time. There used to be these candle clocks, right? And there are seven knob candles. They mark 7 days. So candles are our way of controlling time in a way that with the sun, we can't control it, right? So sun magic is very powerful, but we are kind of like hitchhiking on the back of the sun's power. With candle magic, we are able to change what we want and make it happen. Very important way to light candles is in a triangle. And you light three candles, and as some would say, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Mother, Father, Child, whatever you want to call it, right? That's a very powerful way, and you put your prayer in the middle of the three candles. So there's a lot of symbolism with candles that's unique to candles.
Wow. Rebecca asked if there is a meaning for the candle flame and the direction.
Yes, candle flames have meanings. The directions have meanings, too. Many people will... this goes to another little topic, which is altar layout. Some people like it, like I said, a triangle. And if they want to do good, they put the base of the triangle facing them and the point up to show upward intention of spirit. If they're doing a downward facing triangle, they might be wanting to do something to come to them to accumulate. They might put the candles at the four corners of the altar as best they can to east, west, north, and south. Or they might go on what's called the cross quarters, where they're going to do it at northeast, southeast, southwest, and northwest. And they'll light them in those corners. There is a lot of interpretation about the flame, especially in the spiritualist church. Oh my gosh, there is so much. If the flame flickers, that means that there's, you know, some interference. If the flame goes out, I know so many women told me, They were burning candles on me, and I put their lights out. Now, people think of that as sort of a idiomatic phrase, but to put their lights out really means you blow, and their candle goes out no matter where they are, how many blocks away, how many miles away, their candle will go out. If your candle goes out, that's considered usually to be somebody didn't want you to have that thing, whatever it was, or didn't want you to do that thing. If the flame is high, really high, and the candle burns very, very fast, we say it might happen fast, but it might end in such a way that it doesn't last. It, you know, it just burns too fast. If a light burns so low that the candle flame is just like a little nubbin, like a little glow plug, we say, well, that's slow to work, but it may come to pass that it lasts longer, as long as it doesn't drown or go out. If a candle flame pop, 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 and you'll hear that sometimes, that spirit's trying to get in, and you have to stop what you're doing right then and say, who am I talking to? Who is here? Who sent you? Are you a spirit of God or a spirit of evil? You need to find out who those spirits are who are popping at your candle. And people in the spiritual church wrap the table three times and say, who are you? So yeah, there are many, many customs dealing with the flame and dealing with the smoke of the candle. Yes.
Wow. Wow. Odin asks, has moon magic become obsolete? And why is there less spoken of moon magic?
Oh, gosh. Now, again, this Ramona, this takes us back. I know you're old enough to remember the full moon rising over the Oakland Hills and how beautiful that was. Remember how beautiful that was? And do you remember when they put in BART? They put in BART, and when BART was a rapid transit system, and the rapid transit in Berkeley, which was mostly a white area, they put BART underground. They tore down houses and they put BART all underground, but they, quote, ran out of money when they got to Oakland, where the poor people live, where the poor black people live. And so they put BART up in the air. And then when they did that, they found, oh, people were standing at the stations and there was crime and mugging. So they put in big bright lights. And I'll tell you, there came a day when I watched the full moon rise over the Oakland Hills, just as beautiful as it ever had been when the Ohlone Indians lived there. But the full moon rose under the BART tracks, and I cried because there was no way to go. It just went up under the BART tracks, and then when it came up, you just said, oh, it looks just the same as a street light. You couldn't tell the difference. So there's your answer as to why moon magic has become less important, because people have become so urbanized that the moon rises under the BART, and it'll never shine on Oakland like it used to, and you can't go back. You know, you can't go back unless you tear it all down. And I will say, I hope they tear BART down. Because I want to see the moon rise over Oakland like it used to. They did tear down the Embarcadero Freeway in San Francisco. God bless them.
Finally.
And it was the same thing. The moon, to watch the moon rise under the Embarcadero Freeway, what a curse on the humanity who lived there. So, no, we should always honor and respect the moon. But in order to do that, you have to be ready to recognize that packing people into little apartment buildings, high rises, all that, that's not good. That's not good. We're out of touch with nature. But I'm an old hippie, so you knew I would say that.
Yeah, me too. Me too. That's why I like, you know, it's kind of lonely because I'm out here alone, but I love my trees, my space. I can go outside at night butt naked.
Me too.
Not worry about anyone, you know, seeing me. And I have gone out and danced, you know, under the moon.
Oh, yes.
So I understand, and I noticed that because I took a friend who lives back east on a tour with my phone, you know, and let him see. And I pointed up to the sky, and it was nighttime. And his name is Christopher, and Christopher says, oh, you have the real sky.
Ah, yes. the real
and
stuff.
And you can see the constellations and everything. So
I know what you're saying, and I don't know. Maybe there's just too many people on Earth for this to ever happen again. I don't know. And there are people, I mean, and it's not whether they're young or old, they're people our age who, I'm going to tell you an old way of working a spell that for increase, just a prosperity spell. And you, again, I was taught this by a woman in a candle shop on San Pablo Avenue back in the day. And she said, you go out where the sun, look where the sun rises. She said, look where the sun rises, and you put your hand with your palm up, and then you bring it up over your head like you were scooping it to you, the sunrise to come up. And you say, now bring me my man who will work for me all day long. Bring me a man who will work for me. And she's talking about her husband. Bring me a man who will work for me all day long. She did that several times. So I thought, that's easy. And then she went down over to the west, and she turned to the west. She said, now you go where the sun sets. She put her hand with her palm down, and she like scooped it toward her, like toward her bosom, down and toward her bosom. And she goes, now let him work all day and let him bring his money home to me at night. Very simple prayer spell. So I was telling this to a young Black woman in Oakland on the phone. I live in Sonoma County now. I said to her, okay, I'm going to tell you one right out of Baton Rouge. This is what it is. You just go out there and you do this. You profess to the east where the sun comes up. She goes, how would I know which way the sun comes up? I said, what? She goes, how do I know where the sun comes up? I said, well, you get up in the morning and you watch the sun come up. She goes, I don't get up that early. I said, well, have you ever noticed that the sun comes up pretty much in the same place all the time? She goes, no. I said, all right. Well, she didn't know that the sun comes up in the east. And the sun, and I said, you don't know the sunrise in the east and sets down in the west? She goes, no. I said, what street do you live on? I thought, you know, maybe she just lived on a crooked street or something. She lived on one of those straight up east-west. I said, you look down that street, you're on. Look, when you go out of your house, because I knew where she lived. I said, you go look out of your house. Look to the left. That's where the sun comes up. You see the hills? Now look to the right. That's where the bay is. That's where the sun goes down. She goes, really? How'd you know that? You know? And now I tell the story as funny, but, you know, that's what's wrong with our people.
Yeah.
Our people, it's not that she was stupid. It's not that she was dumb. It's that nobody had ever told her there was a natural world and that this is natural magic.
Right.
Never was schooled in it.
Right. Okay. Laura asked, what are the difference between moon magic and sun magic and rune magic?
What was the third one? Oh, rune. R-U-N-E, rune?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Rune.
Well, let me get rid of rune magic first, okay? Runes are an alphabet that was, crafted in the Scandinavian countries after they got in contact with people who had a Latin alphabet. And it's a regular alphabet. You can write spells in runes, and they were considered to be very powerful. Literacy was not great then, so anyone who could write the spell was considered more powerful than someone who just simply spoke it. And they used to have what they called rune cuffles, which are little sticks of wood, flattened sticks of wood in which you wrote your runes. So rune magic is like any other form of written magic. It could be like Hebrew magic, it could be like Latin magic, it could be like anything. And certain of the runes each have a meaning. So it was used to memorize the runes, but also to have symbolism. So if you were to say, for instance, in A, the letter A, we know Alpha, Omega, God is the beginning and the end. A always starts our alphabet, so that means the beginning. And if you were going to use a spell that had an A at the beginning, you're saying, I'm going to begin this work in this way. Well, the runes have meanings that are symbolic of animals and of people. And so you can make a spell where you're just using the meanings of the symbols that rather than making words out of them. That's rune magic. Put that off to one side. Moon magic and sun magic are magic that take power from the power of nature. And they are similar to, but a little bit more grand than water magic, earth magic, fire magic, and air magic. Because those things are all on our earth, the wind, the water. But if you do magic where you're going to like make a little bottle spell and throw it in water to have it float downstream, you're going with nature. Nature says go downstream. But the moon and the sun are over us all the time. And there's also planets like Jupiter, like Venus, like Mercury. And many people will say, take something like an oil or a water that they're going to bless and sanctify, put it out under the moon, and then use that for things of the moon. Now, things of the moon are things that are changeable and female. Things of the sun are things that are more continuous. But there's also ways you can work with nature that are not the moon and not the sun, like to get lightning struck wood that's been from a tree that's been struck by lightning. That is the power of lightning, which is neither sun nor moon. So all of the sun and moon work is astrological. And then the rest of these larger forms are based on natural. And then we get down to the man-made, like the candle and the sigil and the charm and the amulet. So they're sort of like concentric circles of forms of magic. And then above the sun and the moon, we would say the world of heaven and then the world of the divine. So that's kind of how I characterize them.
Wow. Okay, so we had someone asked, and I just lost my power, but they were saying our holy books, like the Bible and other holy books, are they magic?
Yes. Sacred texts, sacred scriptures have been used in magic all the time. And not every word in every book has had a magical use, but the number of them that do have magical uses is amazing. We talked about the Psalms. Psalms 91 for protection. Open a Bible to Psalms 91 or write it out on a piece of paper and put a pair of open scissors on it if you're kind of a female type, or put a big knife or a machete on it. If you kind of work that way, put it under the bed. No evil can come upon you at night. That Psalm is the magic. The knife or scissors represents the cutting force of that Psalm. There are many other scriptures that are used for love. There are, for instance, Psalms number 46. If you have had a fight with your partner, Psalms 46 is to bring partners back. But if you want someone to have sex with you, Psalms 45, the sexy psalm, it's all about getting a man hard and getting him to entertain his woman. The way he knows best. And so that's used. Psalms 45 is often said by women over food that they're going to give the man to eat. And so, yeah, all of these. Now, there, of course, there are hierarchs in these churches. There are clerical people, usually men, who say, you women, you're all witches out there with the, how dare you pervert the Bible to make a man, you know, get hard for you? Well, if you read the Bible, you'll see it's right in there. So why not, you know? I mean, there's a struggle between magic and religion that I can't solve, but that is a struggle. But the use of books of scripture for divination is another thing. Open your Bible and read at random. Were you ever told that, Ramona?
Oh, yeah, I do that even today.
That's right. That's right.
I really do, ever since I was a little girl, yeah.
And I'll tell you, I once met someone who, I became a very good tarot card reader. And we were talking about, you know, reading cards. And I said, you read cards? And she goes, oh, no, I don't like that. I said, well, do you read playing cards? Because a lot of the older women would read a poker deck, but they wouldn't read tarot. I said, do you read playing cards? She goes, no. She goes, but I read my Bible. And I thought she meant, I don't do magic. I'm so scriptural. She goes, I read my Bible. She goes, you know, you open it three times and there's your answer. So, Bible is used for fortune telling, for divination, for prophecy, for instruction, for guidance, and for wisdom.
Wow. Wow. Gosh, you have such a wealth. You can tell that this is your life.
I guess so, yes.
This is so, so much a part of you. It's like breathing.
Yes.
And it just flows through you. I'm so jealous.
Oh, no. Kein Einharad. Don't be jealous. Don't be jealous. No. I have my strengths and I have my weaknesses. I do have a very useful mind, but I wouldn't say that I have everything else that everybody else has. I mean, we all have our own gifts.
Wow.
You have charisma, for instance. I don't have charisma. Oh, so don't be jealous.
But you do. You do. You make a person feel so at ease. And you're so, you know, so, I don't want to sound cliche, but it's like so earthy.
Well, I'm a tourist. but as my old pastor, Johnny Otis, used to say, well, you buttered me up on one side, turn me over and butter me up on the other side.
You know, I just, wow. Now, what's your favorite form of divination? Talk about a few of the types of divination first.
Oh my gosh, I don't know that I have a favorite. I really love photopsychometry. I really, really love it for relationship divination. That was one of those things. Nobody taught it to me. One day I realized I was gifted at it. And I was like, wow, it's amazing. I just have this gift. So I love photopsychometry because it was given to me. I love the tarot because it's very easy for me. I love the pendulum because I love objects. I love pretty stones. I'm one of those people, if I had my way, I'd have hundreds of different pretty pendulums in boxes. So I could always pick the stone that I liked the best that day. Because I do like things. I like reading candle glass, you know, where the glass encased vigil candles, they'll have smoke and wax remains. And I'm pretty good at reading those. I read them like I read tea leaves. I love reading tea leaves because I love drinking tea and I love the culture of women and tea leaves. And I love astrology. I've been an astrologer since I was 18 years old. And that is one of the real important methods for me, particularly in looking at people's long-term life situations. Each form of divination has its own timelines. Like tea leaf reading, most people will say do it once a week or at the most for 4 weeks, four turns around the teacup to the bottom. Astrology, the pattern in astrology doesn't repeat for 26,000 years. So anytime you cut time and make a chart, boy, that's it for that day. But you can then start predicting long-term things with astrology, especially if couples will get together and stay together, have children, whether that job is right for you. That's long-term. And I like all of those forms of divination, really. Pendulum is really good for yes or no questions. So everyone has their own reason for being. I like throwing the bones, although I have an issue with a lot of bone throwers. They want to kind of own those animals. I call them the enslaved spirits of animals. I don't like that. I only want to work with bones that are cooperating with me. Does that make sense? So that means I have to do a little spiritualist look at those bones and say, all right, is this bone right for me to be holding on to? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. And bone reading doesn't only mean bones. You can have shells and nuts, and you can have little manufactured pieces too. So I do that. Long answer to a short question.
Well, what do you think about tarot cards?
I love tarot. I read tarot all the time. That's what I do. I do that 4 days a week. I read tarot for a living. And I use the Rider-Waite-Smith deck. I've just been using it for so long. I feel like I kind of live in it. It's like I'm just visiting my old friends.
Have you ever Have you ever, like, when I was younger and I had started reading, didn't really know what I was doing, but, you know, like I said, my favorite little old used bookstore and whatnot on Ashby and Berkeley, I just would stumble, be drawn to certain things. Mm-hmm. But what I found is when I started reading tarot cards, I would get confused because a lot of times I found out that all I had to do was be in the, I needed contact with the person.
Yes.
Like I could put my hand on yours.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, do a reading versus, you know, when I started learning the tarot card and I'd be sitting in front of the person, I would start, it's like playing music by ear and reading, you know, you
kind of exactly
confused. And I wondered if you ever ran, well, I guess not because you, this is so much.
No, you are absolutely right. When I start, and I forgot to mention palmistry. Palmistry is another thing I do a lot. Yeah. I'm very good at it. But yeah, palmistry is more for a character analysis, and it'll tell you what occupation to have and things like that. But it won't tell you what will happen next week. You know what I'm saying? Because it takes about 5 years for the lines on your hands to significantly change. So it's a slow read. But I've always started out with palmistry. When I would do a tarot reading, I'd say, let me look at your hands first. And I would be able to read their hands, and then I kind of tune in on them. So when I began to go to reading tarot on the phone, I thought, how can I do this? I don't think I'll be able to do it if I can't touch their hand.
Right.
So I would have them send me a photo, and I would then touch the photo, put my hand on the photo. And these were these little, you know, little snapshots. These are not printouts from a cell phone. These were like actual little photos. And, you know, like, touch the photo, put your hand on it, close your eyes. And all of a sudden I was in contact with them. Then I could read their tarot. It took me years to wean myself away from that so that I would just read the tarot. But even now I will say to them, because I just cannot jump into tarot, I'll say to them, well, ma'am, what is your sign of the zodiac? I always say that because I need an anchor point. And if it's just their sign of the zodiac, a lot of times that now I tell them, just send me a picture of yourself. Send me a selfie. I'll be able to know I'm reading for you. So yeah, tarot for me works best when I have contact with the person. I can do it without now. I mean, I've been doing it for so many years, but I really do feel I have a better reading if I have contact with the person as well as with the cards. I also pick a card to represent them based on your sign of the zodiac.
Yes, yes. Well, listeners, if you are out there, we're going into the last half hour of the show, and if you would like, I think Catherine would be happy to give you a reading.
I sure would.
And you have the call-in number. I've lost my video. I can't see.
But see your name,
Can you see me?
No, I just see your name, Ramona.
Okay. So if you want to call in, the call-in number should be located on the Facebook page. Daryl, give them the call-in number so they can call in. And we did have another question about root magic. Is there a difference of the root magic between the northern and southern hemisphere and your style?
Oh, yes. Urban root magic it tends to have been developed locally, right? So, but there are several streams of acquisition of herbs and roots. And I'm going to quickly outline them for you. So African people live in a tropical area where they can work with fresh herbs all the time. And so there's a lot of use of fresh herbs in African magic. when people were captured and brought as slaves to the Western Hemisphere, some of them were brought to tropical areas like the Caribbean, and they kept a more African way of working with fresh herbs. Those that were sent to the Northern Hemisphere to live in captivity, like the United States, they could not get fresh herbs. First of all, they couldn't get any African herbs because they were brought over naked and in chains. But second, they couldn't even work with fresh herbs because we have all this snow and we have these winters and things that they never have in Africa. So they had to ask around, how do you do it here? And the Native Americans had a tradition of working with dried herbs because they lived in a northern climate. And so did the European slave masters. They also worked with dried herbs. Now, going back to Europe, the very wonderful scented herbs that are used in cooking are Mediterranean herbs. They're high in oils like oregano and garlic and all of those things are more of a, you know, basil. All of those are sort of, they like a warmer climate, but they can, you know, they can be grown from seed or over winter. Rosemary is another one. When the Jewish people were kicked out of Israel due to the diaspora, due to the Roman invasion, they had certain food products and certain food styles that were customary, that you needed to have cinnamon and cloves and all of these things. And the Jews had already set up these trading routes to India, to Africa. And so as they moved into Europe and even up into England, Jews became spice merchants because they needed those spices. They needed the citron. They needed all of these things for their little customs. And so the British people became kind of interested in using these spices. And so when the white people came to America, they brought Jewish spice merchants with them. The black people recognized those spices right away because they knew them from Africa. And they said, oh, so we can get this and use it. So these three streams of magic, European herbs, Middle Eastern spices, and also tropical herbs and North American herbs, plus four streams, were blended. The tropical herbs that were used were those that had a medicinal function, like an anti-fever. Those could be found in pharmacies. So root magic in America is a blend of all of these styles of work that are local. But if you were to study Scandinavian herb and root magic, it would be something quite different because they would be using things like lichen, which are not used so much in America. That's what they got growing up there. All right, that's enough of that, but I think you get the point. Going back to hoodoo in America, the sale of herbs and roots into the black community after the Great Northern Migration was mostly accomplished by Jewish traders and pharmacists and spice merchants. And so there is a overlap there between the use of Jewish sigil magic, like the 6th and 7th books of Moses, and the use of Jewish magical spices like cinnamon and cloves, which were also magical in Africa. It's cross-cultural.
Wow. Daryl, can you tell us what a good call-in number
Yes, I definitely have a call-in number for you, Ramona. All right. For anyone desiring to call in, I will give you the middle of the United States number, which is 1-669-900-6833. And the meeting ID number is 698-757-2639. And let me repeat the number. 1-669-900-6833. And the meeting ID number is 698-757-2639. And there's no passcode or nothing. I've just eliminated that. And I want everyone who's listening to make sure to get in contact with her. I know it was 15 minutes left and people are working and very few people are home now. They're, you know, opening up. But I want people to get in contact with this woman. This woman has just made me go, wow. I mean, blew my mind. And that's why I got to talk to her afterwards.
Now, let's, Kat, can you give Daryl a reading?
Oh, yes. I sure can. Kat, you know I'm one of those guys that says use me as a test dummy.
I'm gonna try to list them all, the numbers.
All right, I'll give you a reading, Daryl, but I'm gonna ask you a couple questions.
Okay.
What's your sign of the zodiac?
I am a Cancerian.
Cancerian.
Yeah,
all
but
right.
I'm gonna give you a little bit more information. I was born in 1970. During the heart of the lunar eclipse in North Carolina.
Oh my. Wow. All right. So that's a definitely you're a lunar person. All right. Now there are two ways I can give a reading. One is a general reading. It would just be three cards on things you need to know. Or you can ask a question and I will answer the question with three cards. Which would you prefer?
You know, with you, I'm gonna have to go on the wild side because this deity in me just loves the wild side. Let's go for the three cards. Open general. I'm a good gambler.
Just general read.
General read. I'm a good gambler.
This is what you need to know. Number one. Okay, card number one. Is a card that is called the chariot. I'm sorry, I couldn't quite hear you. Say again.
Ramona, what did you say?
Uh-oh.
Am I off?
I could not quite hear you. Can you hear me?
I hear you. Ramona.
All right, well, I'll just keep talking.
Okay, keep talking.
All right. Card number one is called the Knight of Cups. So this is good for a water sign person. It is a man on a horse who has come across a dry desert. Things have been not as fluid as he would wish. He comes to a stream of water. He's on a horse that is moving forward. That horse represents your body. It tells me that your body is in generally good health, but he's looking for more water. And I'm going to tell you straight up, one of the meanings of this card is be sure you hydrate. And he's got a golden goblet, and he comes to this stream of water where he can water his horse, that is to say his body. And he also can, holding this cup, he can find what the cup represents. The cup, the Holy Grail, can mean spirituality, it can mean love, and it can also mean an interest in divination itself. Across the stream, there is a rock wall, a cliff, and at the top of the cliff are two oak trees together. And two oak trees represents cooperation. It can be a husband and wife, or a husband and a husband, a wife and a wife, a mother and a child. It can be two business partners. It can be a teacher and a student. But these two oak trees grow together and help each other. This is where he wants to go. He wants to be in a place where there is harmony and cooperation, but he cannot get there because you can't go up a sheer rock wall cliff. So this is a card that's going to teach you about patience. You're going to have to turn and go downstream. There's about a dozen little willow trees. Now, willow trees are sacred to the moon, which happens to be the ruler of Cancer. Willow trees have silver leaves underneath, and they sparkle a little bit in the light, you know, in the moonlight. And willows are also the source of aspirin. So willow is used to stop pain. And these little willow trees are flexible. You cannot build a house out of willow, but you can build a basket out of it. Right? And he's going to go down through these willows and then around and back. And he's going to come up the long way up the hill, and eventually you will be on that high cliff. But who are these dozen willow trees? So this represents people around you who will be cooperators, who will help you, but they will not be strong enough for you to build your life upon. They will not be your partners, but they will be your friends. And if these are to be business partners, these are cooperators. If they are to be lovers, they are gentle, sweet lovers who are friendly to you, but it is not your marriage. If it's to be development of yourself, these are aspects of yourself that come from dreams. Okay, so, but you will find the path, but you will have helpers along the way. Don't lose sight of the goal, because you will win in the end. But this is a card that's sometimes called the card of delay. The next card is a card that is called temperance. So this is a card that's called the interrupted journey. It shows a path that is leading from where we stand up to the mountains and to a crown in glory. It's a crown just made of light. But there's a washout on the path. There's water just run across the path. So these are two cards with water on them, which is interesting. Now this one shows an angel, and the angel is holding two golden goblets and pouring water from one to the other, and not a drop is spilled. And this is called two minds with but a single thought, or two hearts that beat as one. And this angel is the angel Raphael, who is the angel of travelers, and the angel of partnerships, and the angel of health and healing, the angel of natural health and healing, and particularly eating a good diet. And when I get this card, one of the things you need to know is you should be taking your omega-3. You take your fish oils.
Fish.
That's real important.
Fish. Fish. And that's guess what? I'm going to say it. Yeah, that's what I'm eating tonight. That's what I'm eating tonight is fish. I mean, for the past three, four nights in a row, it's fish. And the traveler.
Good. That's what Raphael says. Eat fish.
And everything you're mentioning. Oh, go ahead. I can't stop you. Go. You're hitting everything. Go.
All right. So behind this angel, there's a batch of iris flowers. You know, those flowers that bloom in the spring. And they look like a little woman's lady parts, the flower. So this is called Queen Elizabeth Root, the root of the power of women. And so that says, look to women for strength. It won't make you less of a man. But if you have good female strength around you, you'll be very strong. Raphael has the sun on his head like a halo. And he has the name of God, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, Jehovah, on his robe, like a choir robe. One foot on land and one foot in water. So the angel is saying, walk on, walk through the water. Now, some people call it the water of baptism. Some people call it the water of cleaning. Some people call it, you know, a ritual bath of some sort. Take a ritual bath. Then get back on the path. You go over the hills, over the valleys, over the dark valleys, over the mountains, and up to a crown. So this is one of the best cards in the deck. And it tells me that Angel Raphael will watch out and help you. Same Raphael that they named the town of San Rafael, California after. And I'm going to give you one more card. And this is the card of the Page of Pentacles. And this is a man who is looking up in a beautiful dawn sky. And there are three forms of earth around him. A mountain, which is to say Capricorn, the origin of earth. A forest, which is to say Taurus, stable earth. And a little field that's been plowed, which is Virgo, which is changeable earth. And in front of him are little wildflowers. And it says, Earth lays out all her treasures for you. And he holds up his hands, and on the tips of his fingers and on the tips of his thumbs, he receives a coin from heaven, but as lightly as if it were a bubble. This is a piece of money that will come to you, but it's not enough to totally change your life. Maybe it's the stimulus, I don't know. But he's holding up his hands. It's an opportunity. It's not, I was making a joke there, but it's an opportunity will come to you. Do not grab at it. Do not try to take it, but let it sit lightly in your hands and look at it. It's a gift from God. It's a gift from nature. And when the springtime comes again, it's a good time to plant, and it's a good time to harvest in due time. This card is about beginning a new project, about a gift of money. And that's your reading.
Okay. Wow. Okay. Hold on. I got to say it. Ready? You're on point.
Yeah.
Again. I did get a very, very generous offer that came to me. And the offer was not about the network. It was for a usage of this network. And
wow.
I'm sitting back, very generous. I mean, we just got into the Federal Bureau of Prisons. We're literally everywhere, literally in all countries. And we even had Russians using a translating program listening to this show tonight, and some Chinese.
Wow.
And Indians, and four people from Pakistan. I'm looking at my server now. We're killing them on numbers. The thing is that I'm sitting here and I'm like, she just hit me on every point. And they weren't general points. Those are specific little areas you hit. I mean, even to my life right now, which is so different from my life in the past. Mm-hmm. I mean, 2 months ago, 3 months ago, I was a little bit more, as Ramona would say, a little bit more obnoxious. Ramona, would that be a good word? Yeah, that would be a good word. Asshole-ish? Yeah, that would be me. I had a lot going on, and I had to make sure I keep the ship floating. So now I got a captain, Captain Steve-O. He's got the ship. But, you know, I had to make sure everything was floating well. And, you know, it's the image that contains, that people see of this network, of the leadership that makes it work. And I like I said, I do everything to the point, and I have no choice but to. Yeah, I was off the hook. I was off the hook. She ain't gonna lie. I was off the hook. But on the other side, now it's more contained, more everything is on point, and I'm doing everything as it should be. And I'm very proud of that. Now, with what you said, I know that I can't jump at every offer or everything because there are bigger things coming in the background. I mean, with what we have been, my life has been experiencing, mm-hmm. this past 2 weeks has been enough. I mean, car stolen. Hey, guess what? I went out and bought a car. It was just that simple. Just went out and got a car. Let's see. Things are changing. I'm thinking of buying houses. I have an offer for a home in Scottsdale, Arizona. I have an offer for a home here in Virginia. I mean, things are coming, and it's happening so quickly. It's like, are you at the right place at the right time? No, I'm traveling that wave of destiny. I'm following. Mm-hmm. I'm not fighting destiny no more. I'm not trying to create my own path. I did that when I was younger. Now, you know, I got some more blue in my hair. I got to get some more color, too. I need to get some more colors in my hair because, I mean, the more colors I have, the better I feel. And that's the changes that have occurred. You're dynamite. You even came to the point where you gave those three signs. One is somebody I know very close to me right now, actually in the other room. The other one is her brother, and the other one is her sister. Those three signs were all three individuals. And that was scary.
Wow.
I mean, that right there was like, huh? You didn't say cancer. You just said, I'm like, hold on. Yeah. Okay, so I know I'm on the right path. Is there something that you can tell me to confirm that, I mean, I know this network's getting ready to blow up. I'm looking at another industry, which is marketing and promotion within the federal government. I want this network to play in not only the Federal Bureau of Prisons, I want to play in every state's local jails. I mean, the knowledge on this network is immense, mm-hmm. and that's what my plan is in the end. Can you see, if that's going to occur, or is that too ambitious of me? I mean,
now you go into a question. See, everybody who asks for a general reading ultimately does have a question. That's a secret I'll tell you as a reader.
but you led me to that point. You led me.
But I'll tell you, I'm going to give you some advice based off these cards. Number one, Knight of Cups. Remember I told you you're moving forward, but you're not going to reach that goal. That's that higher goal right away. You got to go through these 12 little willow trees. So these are people who'll be your helpers along the way. Take your time, get to know them all, and they will be your helpers and get you through. Number two is that angel, Raphael. Raphael means the healer of God or God's doctor. If you emphasize that there is healing to be had, you will go farther faster. If it shows you will have success, absolutely. I would also say with both of these cards, there's water. So personally, I would use bathing to make sure that you're doing God's work, that you're doing something very, very good. If you find anybody along this path that has names like Knight or Raphael or anything, look at them as a sign. Elizabeth is another one. Queen Elizabeth, Ruth, Iris. These are all words that crown. These are all words that are in these cards. The third one says, don't rush it. You're going to be given a real gift here of money. You will be given something very, very useful. And look forward. Don't drag your heels. These two people in the cards are moving forward. The angel is looking us right in the face and saying, nothing is lost. Everything is going to be for the good, for the healing of people. So it were me, and I was going to give you one more card. All right. I'm going to pull one more card, and that card is the Eight of Wands. So this shows eight sticks or wands that have been thrown through the air and are coming down. They're going to land. Gravity means they're going to land. So this is called the card called Good News is on the way and it cannot be stopped. So it isn't as if you even have to hustle for it. Good news will arrive. Now, what is the number eight? It could be maybe 8 days, 8 weeks, 8 months. Way in the background, there is a ruined castle, an old castle that's just fallen into rocks and stones. And this is the beginning of a new cycle. These wands are going to come down. They are already bursting into leaf. And when we say where God plants them, they will grow.
Right.
So news is on the way. It's going to come to you. Just follow what God leads you toward, because it says almost you don't have to do a lot. It's going to come to you. All right. Just like that previous card, the Page of Pentacles, it just arrives. Wow. But be true and good. Always work with partners. That's what those first two cards say.
8 days, 8 weeks, 8 months.
I 100% agree with you, and I understand that. I mean, my former partnership went to ruin for greed. And this partnership that I have now is a lot better, smoother, it's more congruent, as we will say. I mean, if I have a stress, I just speak on it. If not, I'm doing my thing, doing it the way I do it, and it works.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like, as they called back in the day, the Midas touch. I mean, in reality, I'll say it openly. Name a radio network that's been in the Federal Bureau of Prisons, and it's 1.6 million listeners. And look, and it's 1.6 million listeners. None.
Yeah.
I'm the only one. I'm the first and the only. And I accomplished that goal because I tell the truth. I keep it honest. I don't have no cut cards. I tell people, if you ask, you better ask the right question. You know what I mean? Because you might get the total answer, and the total answer is the extension of the right question, and it might hurt you. I like to say truth does hurt sometimes. But
when I look at what I've developed, I mean, I got great hosts like Ramona. She's monster. I mean, she's a monster host. She's a Godzilla. And I tell people, you know, my hosts are all Godzillas. They know what they're doing, and it's natural. That's what I want. I want that organic, natural host. I don't want that somebody that sits back and say, well, I got to sit there and I got to think about this question. Maybe I'd offend them. Maybe it won't. Hold on. This is year 2021. I got to think. No, I don't want that person. I want somebody that's going to say, you know something? The question's got to come natural. I mean, it's got to be that conversation between two people. And that's the... That's why there's 68,000 people listening to this show right now, because there are people that are just like, I'm at work, and I wish I could do more. I wish I could call in. It should have been later at night. Daggone it. Got the kids, and they're running around the house. They're going crazy. I still got school going on. Little rats. I should have sent y'all back to the classroom.
Now, see, that's what I was saying. That's what I was saying, man. Those 12 little willow trees. Not any one of them is strong enough to carry everything. You see, every little willow tree is bendable, but when you put them all together, they will lead you to where you want to go, which is that strong oak, right? Yeah. You want to get up to where the oak trees are, where you can really, really build. But never neglect the fact that those flexible, those people, you said those hosts, whatever it's going to be, people will help. Also, be kind to women. That's so Raphael says, because of Queen Elizabeth, we'd always be kind to women, and you will achieve your crown.
Yeah, I've learned that lesson a long time ago. That came from my grandpa. Right. I say it, that came from grandpa, okay? Not you, Ramona, grandpa.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I love my Ramona for one reason. I'm going to tell you.
And drink lots of water.
Lots of water. All right, I'll start drinking water. Does beer count?
That does beer count. Well, just keep hydrated. That's
okay. Okay.
Raphael is the card of health. I'm gonna tell you. Raphael is the card of natural healing and natural health. And like I said, fish and also with Raphael, in the story of Raphael, he goes to a well. And there's a well where they drink, and there's also fish that he catches in the river. So it's all about natural things. So
well water is the best water. Well water.
Raphael also kills a demon, by the way, in the story of Raphael. He slays a demon.
Well, I'm going to have to call on Raphael a couple of times in a week. Ramona, she's 100%. I can't argue with her. I after the show, I gotta ask. Okay, after the show, I ain't gonna say that. After the show, I'm gonna ask.
That's why I love her, and I was so stressing to get her on this show.
Listen, so kind. I made ways for this. I broadcasted two shows tonight at the same time, so you know I've lost my mind. I had to do it, and I was like 3 o'clock. Okay, I could do this. I could do this. I'm gonna get yelled at, but I could do this. But I had to do it because I saw the first show, there was something about you. There was some information that I was like, wow, how does she know this? And then it got deeper in this show. I mean, that first show was just like the ice cream, but you forgot the cake. Now you get to taste that good old cake down there, and it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. This is that velvet, you know, that red velvet cake, you know.
I want Kat to come back again.
Honey, you can't keep me away. You just open the door and I'll walk
whenever
back.
You want.
Yeah, let you open.
I would have you on every Monday afternoon.
Oh, well, I tell you get tired of me soon enough. But any Monday that you want me, I'm here, because on Monday I don't schedule any readings. So on Monday I'm just here. That's my free day. And I love it, you know, to spread some of this around and you know, just tell some truths. That's what I'm here for. So, but you got to go through my husband,
yes.
Nagashiva Ironwood. He is my manager. And it, we just tell him what we need. He's always there. He's my tech guy, right? I can't do it without my tech guy. And and I hope you don't mind that I don't show my video of myself. And I'll tell you why. Two reasons. One is I'm an old lady, and you'd just as soon not see it, old lady, because, you know, people make fun of old ladies.
No, they That's don't. Not on my network, they don't.
No, but you're a pretty old lady. You're not old. Oh. Not compared to me.
So hold on. Not on my network, they don't.
67.
How much?
67.
Well, you know what they say, black don't crack.
Ooh.
That's why you look so young. I don't. So that's number one. I'm an old lady. But number two is, in my way of being, I try to keep myself from being a celebrity. I don't. Yeah. I try to keep myself humble. Ask a question, I'll answer it. Tell me you want some help doing something, I'll help you. So I don't try to make a big point of who I am, but I'm always willing. If you want to have me on every other week or whatever, I'd be glad to do it. I also have a radio show of my own, and you know that, right?
Yes.
And I'd like to have you on my radio show, right?
Oh my God.
Hold on. How about this one? As the network owner, I like to syndicate your radio show. I'm going to talk to the boss.
Well, you got to talk to me. You and Nagashiba talk.
Yeah, I got to talk
to the boss. We've been doing the Lucky Mojo HooDoo Rootwork Hour since 2004.
I wish I had y'all on.
We discuss HooDoo. We give spells, and we have a free spell every week. It's on every Sunday at 3 p.m. Pacific time on Blog Talk Radio. And, but I would love to have you as a guest and talk about what you do, you know.
Come on, Ramona. Say agree. Agree, woman. Agree. Agree, please.
Agree. All right. That's a deal. We'll work it out. We'll get Nagashiba to work it out for us.
Yeah.
You'll find out soon enough. I couldn't do anything without that man. He's my right hand.
Oh, he's wonderful.
Yes, he is. Wonderful. I think that's the word most people use. They say he's wonderful, and I'm here to say yes. I'm the luckiest woman in the world to have him as my helper.
Yeah. That's you put that spell out.
I did. I said I wanted the best man in the world for me, and he appeared.
So, and you got him.
Yeah, I got him.
I got to try that.
You got yes. Well.
I always thought that if I did get one, and what if I got tired of them? How could I get rid of them?
You find one that good, you never get tired. You find that one that good, you wake up every morning and say, "Oh Lord, another day with this beautiful man." That's what you say. I just hope I don't run out of days because this man is so good. That's when people say that they're afraid of doing a love spell because it might lead to a commitment. That's what stops love spells from working. If you put your heart into it and say, I am here for the right person who's going to come to me and be my partner and be my love. We're going to go through life together as a dyadic couple, wrapped in each other's arms, squeezing each other's hands, walking side by side, lifting things together. God will provide, you know, knock and it shall be opened unto you.
Yeah.
Amen. 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 Amen.
But so many women, and a few hundred men as well, they say, "Well, I just want to try them all out and find the best one." But that'll waste
your life. I always look for love, and thought that it would. I'm so romantic and so, you know, just. And it didn't work out. And I don't know, I just kind of just said, okay, well, at least I've loved and lost.
Oh, man. I've been there about 5 or 6
times. And it's been over 20 years.
Yeah. Well, sweetheart, it's never too late to open up your heart again if you feel it. If you don't feel it, you know, it isn't as if being in a partnership is the only way to live. I talk to a lot of women. I'm working on a book right now called Down Home Sex Magic. It'll be out this summer. It'll be out for the virtual HooDoo Heritage Festival. And I used to think everybody would want sex magic. They all would want it. But I have met a lot of men and women who say, no, I did that. I've done it. I'm cooking instead, or I'm raising Pomeranian puppies, whatever. No, really, they are. But I'm not one of the, those people. I'm one of those people. I'm that girl that if I didn't have a boyfriend, I'd just literally throw my clothes off and run naked in the streets until I found one.
Yeah.
I'm just, you know, that's just something. I'm just that built that way. I'm just, you know, I'm not saying that's the right way to be. It got me in a lot of trouble. I mean, I got into all kinds of trouble by throwing myself at inappropriate men just because they had a dick, you know?
Yeah.
Just saying. I mean, you know, I did that. But
been there, done that.
Been there, done that, right. But I but I learned how to ask God for more than just that, to ask God for a partner. And if there's anything this book I'm working on is going to teach people is that down-home sex magic really is also love magic. And love is love is the beauty, you know. And love doesn't necessarily...
Can I order books straight through Lucky Mojo?
Absolutely. LuckyMojo.com. Okay. And if you go to LuckyMojo.com and look for the you can go to Google and just type Lucky Mojo Publishing.
Yeah, okay.
And there's a page of all the books we've published. We've published almost 3 dozen books now. And you can get deals and bargains. You know me, I'm just one of those little old Jews who wants to make everyone have a bargain. So you can buy like 6 books on one topic or 3 and you get discounts. So instead of being $9 each, they might be $8 each. And if you buy a dozen of them, they're going to be $7 each. So we're trying to get this stuff at a bargain for people.
Yeah.
We also give books away every Friday. We have something called Facebook Fridays. If you go to the Lucky Mojo Facebook page on Friday, every other Friday we give away free books. And every other days we give away oils.
Hold on. Did you say free books?
Handmade oils.
Free books?
Free books.
And give them your Patreon address, too. I'm one.
Okay, great. Thank you. Oh, that's so sweet. And I was going to say something because y'all had mentioned prisons. We send free books to prisoners on Hoodoo Folk Magic. Now, we cannot send them books on candle magic because they can't be used in a candle, right?
Right.
But we can, because they'll confiscate those, right?
Yeah.
Because they never let them do that. But we can send all types of free books. To send them to a prison, you have to send them directly from the publisher.
Right.
Some jails will let them to have anything, but most places it has to come from the publisher to avoid that it had any contraband in it.
Right.
And so if people write to us from a federal prison, we will send them books. Not a whole stack at once, one at a time. If they like that one, they can ask for another one. And we have books on all types of things, and not just on hoodoo. We have a book on trolldom, on Scandinavian folk magic. And so some people like that book. And we have a book on North Asian, Manchurian and Mongolian folk magic. So we'll send those books as well if people ask for them. It helps if they know what they want. But I know from experience that the candle magic books will be confiscated.
Yes. Yes. Because, you know, another person who used to do that, Elizabeth Clare Prophet.
Yes. Yes.
Her organization would send books from the Lighthouse.
That's right. The Lighthouse.
Summit Lighthouse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We also will send people a free tarot deck if they're in a prison, if they want to learn to read tarot. We try to do, you know, I need to back up here. What I have not talked about it. I got interested in urban root magic very early on, and it took me down a path I should not have gone. I ended up in incarcerated because of growing marijuana back in the day when it was against the law, back in the day. And so I know what it's like to be locked up. And I have a lot of heart and sympathy for people who've been locked up, and I try to help. That's just me.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that cannabis now one of your herbs?
I don't sell it. No, I don't. I've decided against, unless it becomes federally legal, I will not sell it because I don't want it. I just don't want to go back to jail. I've been there, yeah. done that, you know. Yeah. But what, the day it becomes federally legal, sure, of course I'd sell it. I sell tobacco. I sell tobacco, and that has caused PayPal to not want to carry our products because PayPal has a mat on against tobacco. But tobacco is used in ritual, especially by Native Americans. And so I don't smoke it, but I use it in incense.
Right? Yeah.
And I'm just hard-headed enough that rather than say, oh, just go down and break a camel in half, I'll get them some really good sacred tobacco. But that makes people you have to get a special license to sell tobacco in the state of California. You know, I'm crazy, but that's what's the truth. So, yeah.
All but natural things.
Yeah, I sell, but I will sell cannabis if it comes down to it, you know, to be legal.
Yeah.
But I did my time. I'm not going to go there again.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's what stops the pharmaceutical companies from actually working with the cannabis. Because it's not federally, and yet it has so many health benefits. So
it sure does. It sure does. But even like, remember I mentioned the willow. Remember I mentioned the willow in that card.
Yeah.
The willow has many, many health benefits. But nowadays they want you to take a white pill. Well, take this aspirin.
Yeah.
But they won't tell you. Just boil up some willow bark tea. And so I'm a great one for teaching people use natural things. Now, of course, when I was young, any place you went, you could find willow trees. Everybody had them growing by their house. Why? Because they needed them for a painkiller, right? Willow was the most cultivated tree by people's homes. And nowadays, people, just like they don't know where the moon rises, they don't know where the sun rises, and they don't know where the willow trees grow either. And so, you know, they are doomed to take that aspirin and pay money for it, and it upsets their stomach, where they could have a willow leaf tea and a willow bark tea, and it would be very good for them.
Wow.
So it is.
Well, Kat, I really appreciate you being here. I hope we can do this again and again and again, because on this end, you know, from the people, I think the more they get back, the better it is.
I agree on that. And you know, for me, a lot of the use of magic, I need to explain this. People think of someone doing magic to show that they have power. But for me, to do magic is just another tool in the big tool chest, you know, if you got to get yourself straight legally, you got to get yourself straight in terms of the work you do. You got to have the right friends. You got all these things or tools that you need, social tools, legal tools. And then magic is that extra tool. And faith is another tool, but I use them all together, use them together. And so what I tell people is it's not about, you know, I'm the big queen muckety muck of sorceresses. You know, it's not about that. It's about get where you need to go. Have the life you want. Plan your life. It's you got this.
So true. But thank you so much. And we have to again, because there's still more and more.
All right. Well, just contact Shiva and I'll be here. And I feel so blessed that you had me on and that I get to know you. next time I'm going to interview you and ask you about your life.
Oh, it's dull and boring.
Well, all right.
But thank you so much, and I will be getting in contact with, because we have to do this one more time. And there's just this connection between the two of us. And I've been following you for so long. And, just one of the chats out there. And even, I keep saying we have met in California. And I know it. I feel it.
I'm very sure we have.
Figure out where it was.
Yeah. When did you leave California?
I left California in 2001.
Okay. I was gone for a few years in between and came back. I was born in 1947. Well, I lived in California all my life up until 1972. Went away, came back in the mid-80s, and that's it.
That's when I left. I went to Chicago.
In 72,
and came back like 4 years later. Went to Paris, came back.
Oh my. Well, I think I know you from older though, from before. I mean, I'd say when you said Peralta, I'm like, I know exactly what church that was. I mean,
little island in the middle.
That little triangle. I know exactly where you mean. I used to live, and I grew up, I lived on Grant Street for a while, on McGee Street. Then my mother worked for the University of California. I went to the Whittier School District and just lived down in the Berkeley Flats, down on, I've lived on houses all around, down on Adeline. I lived on for a while on Tulare Street. It's about everything.
My mom and uncle, they grew up on Adeline, 12th and Adeline.
That's that area. I know exactly where that is. Ashby, I lived on Ashby for a while. Path.
That's all I know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Somewhere, and it's just like, when we talk like we just old friends. And
that's right.
I can't explain the feeling, but you know what I'm talking about. And I'm
do.
Just so blessed.
I do. And you ought to meet Ms. Robin also. Ms. Robin York Thornton. She's now Thornton. When I met her, it was the same thing. Her mother is my age, and Robin is a bit older than my daughter. And Robin is another one of these people who grew up, used to go to Ancient Ways and buy her stuff, go to Linda's Candles, go to the Phoenix Candle Company, all that stuff out on in East Oakland. But Ms. Robin is now living in Pittsburgh, California. She is a really good worker. You might want to just hook up with her. She's a wonderful person. And she was the founder of the HooDoo Heritage Festival. Her people are from Texas originally, but she, she grew up in Oakland and then lived in Berkeley on Oregon Street, right on the other side of Ashby. Just that little no man's land.
I will look her up. I'll tell her Kat sent me.
Yeah, that's right. And you can find her. You can find her at AIR, Association of Independent Readers and Rootworkers. And her name is Ms. Robin.
Ms. Robin. Thorne. Thank you so much.
All right, hon. Well, I'm going to move on and
Enjoy the rest of your day.
What I'm doing right now is getting a box of goodies ready for my Patreon patrons. I send them old vintage stuff, and I'm sending them old herb catalogs from the 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s that have the list of herbs and even have recipes for herbal medicine in them. and these are duplicates from my collection. So everybody who becomes my patron at a certain level gets these boxes of antique stuff.
Wow.
So that's what I'm going to do, is go and organize my boxes.
Well, I'm going to go feed my horses and everything. And thank you so much again.
All right.
And
well,
thank you, Nagasiva.
All right.
For hooking us up.
All right.
And I'll talk to you soon.
All right. Bye-bye.